Let's do it live. Let's do it live, baby.
All right. Hashtag the beast. Oh, God. It's awful. It's so bad.
What? Welcome.
All right. Let's adjust this a little bit. And we'll adjust that a little bit.
I wish I could see what you see, Brian.
There we go. You will if you watch the YouTube version. What's going on, guys? Welcome to episode 130 of the Beastly Thought Show. Woo! Thank you guys so much for joining us. I don't know why I could hear my own voice in my headphones, but I'll turn that off now. And I think we're good. I'm actually really excited for this show because, I'm really excited to hear what Robbie's got to say about Titanfall. It's a game I bought, but I haven't played yet. I was actually thinking about playing it today, but I just ran out of time. And Beastly, you got the PS4 VR headset, so I'm looking forward to hearing what you got to say about that. Yeah. So why don't we start off with Robbie? Robbie, what have you been playing this week? I know you're going to talk about Titanfall. I'm looking forward to hearing about it. Go ahead.
Yeah, so basically this week I've been playing Battlefield 1 as well, because love that game. Fantastic single player, love the multiplayer.
Yeah.
Probably one of my favorite Battlefield games ever. I mean, yeah, pretty much simple enough. Love the game.
So you've been back and forth between that and Titanfall 2, huh?
No, it's more just like the start of the week I was playing Battlefield 1, because Titanfall 2 didn't come out until Friday, so I was playing kind of up until the lead up until that. And yeah, of course I've been playing Titanfall 2, and I have a lot to say about this game. So starting with the campaign, I think they did a really good job. Not even necessarily with the story. The story is really cool. It's basic, but it's a lot of fun. There's just these really awesome moments. I'm not going to spoil anything. Every single level feels varied and different. There's some really, really ingenious platforming sections where it's like you're in this factory and you have the platform. I think the shooting feels excellent. Everything just feels very tight and very responsive. I mean, it's basically, yeah, Titanfall, but they made a storyline out of it. It is basic, but I think they did a good job. I think the performances are good. The acting is good. And at the end of every couple levels, too, there will be like this mini boss fight against a couple Titans. You'll get like the Ronin Titan with the sword and stuff like that. Or it'll be like Tone. He has the big, you know, semi-auto cannon. I mean, it's just a lot of fun. Basically, the campaign is like just so fun to play through. That's what's really been hooking me. And there are some really interesting mechanics they bring into it.
So apparently when they were developing the campaign, what they were doing is they were taking a bunch of kind of small ideas, right? And they were like saying, what would be fun? What would be a fun thing to do in this game? And then they took, you know, however many of them, like let's say they had 20 fun ideas. They narrowed it down to like the top 12. And then they basically designed the campaign around those ideas, as opposed to, you know, having the story all laid out and then trying to fit gameplay in. They took the gameplay that they thought would be fun and then made a story to fit around that gameplay, which is a really interesting way to do it. Yeah. I've heard the campaign. It's fantastic. It's like
the story is so cool, too, because you play as the same pilot the entire game, Jack Cooper, and he's assigned to his Titan BT-7274. I remember the name correctly.
Wow, Robbie. And God, I miss being 14. I couldn't remember that shit.
And there are some really up and down moments. Like, you know, you start to really care about him and you start to care about BT and stuff like that. And I'm not going to spoil anything, but there are definitely some moments where I was like, whoa. The sad moments here and there, and there was
The Beastly Gamer's got some questions for you right now. The Titans in Titanfall 2, are they sentient? Are they self-aware? Is it like an AI type of machine? Is it able to talk to you and be, does that concern for you?
They all have their own lines and stuff like that. Like even BT, when you're not piloting him and you're not inside of him, he has his own voice. Like he's like, he has a personality. He speaks to you, and I think he's really.
Yeah. Is he ever, goes back and forth? Now, my second question for you, Robbie, because you have more experience than Briar and I at this, do you like it more when you're inside of him?
Oh, boy. I'd
say early in the show for that kind of. we don't get into the dick jokes until about the last 5 minutes, but all right. We're going to start the show off that way? Hell, I'm down. I'm on board.
A serious question, okay? Titanfall, the original game, it seriously lacked any type of story mode. It was kind of tacked on. Have you beat this campaign already?
Yeah, the campaign's short. It's only, I'd say, 4 to 5 hours. I played it on hard, which was a little bit difficult, but it's just got such cool set pieces. Like, and more than anything, I just had a blast playing through it. Like, what they did, it was just really smartly designed and well done. I thought they did an excellent job with it. And the only thing that was kind of disappointing, I won't spoil again, but they of course they're going to do this. They kind of leave room for a Titanfall 3. They really don't explicitly do it, but you know what I mean? It's like, if they wanted to do a sequel, they could.
Well, that, the war's not over, right? Like, whatever war there isn't over.
It's not over. Definitely isn't.
But that's the best way for a company to do it, rather than them just lay out the foundation for the next game, and you know, the way that you kind of described it is, it could go either way, right?
Yeah, they could close the door on it, or they could do a sequel, which I like when they do that.
The best way to go, rather than just shoehorn an ending in there and you say, okay, like kind of like what's the game with
Halo 2?
I'm thinking what's Quantic Dreams game on PS3 with Ellen? What's her name? Ellen Page?
Oh yeah, I forgot what was the name of that game.
No, the one that came
Beyond
out.
Beyond Two Souls.
Beyond Two Souls, the end of that game where she was standing on top of this mountain in the future. Of course, the game would probably never happen. But at that point, you're like, holy shit, all this for nothing. Now I got to wait and buy another game. I prefer them to kind of leave the door open to kind of let your mind wonder what's going to happen here, what could happen. And even if they decide not to, you're content with the ending. Is that how you felt at the end of Titanfall 2? Is it an ending that could be, you know, contain the entire story? Or do you feel like at the end of the game you need to see more? Is there a lot more questions?
There were a couple things. Again, like I'm gonna, you know, be very careful about how I word this. Would have liked to see the campaign be a little longer. There could have been some things that could have been fleshed out more, like especially the characters. When you find a new faction leader and you battle him and his Titan, like there's not much to those characters, and they're kind of just. I don't want to say thrown away, but, you know, there's just, it's like if they had a couple more hours of length in this campaign, it could have been even better, I think, with the story, and it could have fleshed out things even more.
All right, well, it doesn't sound like you're disappointed by the campaign, which is a good thing. Now, let me ask you about the multiplayer, which also kind of got critically panned initially in Titanfall 1 because there was a lack of content, no weapons and different player modes. After playing the multiplayer of Titanfall 2, do you feel like they've rectified the issues of the original game? And if so, can you kind of elaborate on how?
100%. I think they have definitely fixed that. Like, right, it's basically Titanfall 1's multiplayer with more added on, more modes. My favorite thing is that there's new Titans, and each of them feels distinct. Like, you know, you have Scorch. He has a massive fire cannon when he can shoot fire and things like that. There's like Tone, who has a semi-auto millimeter cannon, things like that. Wildstar, which has like a sniper rifle that you can charge up and do massive damage. Like each of the Titans feels varied, and they have their own unique abilities, which I love. I think they improved on that a ton. Like the Titans feel like they have their own personalities this time around.
Wow. Okay, well, I'm looking forward to this. Once my bank account recovers from this recent purchase,
they I'll probably... play so differently, which is my favorite part of the multiplayer. Like absolutely different play styles for each of them.
Another question, because you guys know how I am. I got question after question. Titanfall 1, they had this multiplayer mode that encompassed, what, I think 4 or 6 actual human players with a plethora of non-player characters or computer-controlled AI. Yeah. Is it the same thing, or can you play against other humans without the AI? Have they changed any of that, or are there different modes? Because I know the original Titanfall added modes that allowed you to just be human versus human later on down the line.
Yes, so most of the modes in the game do have players, Titans, and AI, so you get all three of those. There is a couple modes, like, of course, there's Last Titan Standing, which is mainly like a search and destroy type mode, but you're in your Titan the whole time, trying to kill the enemy Titans to win. There's Pilots versus Pilots, which is just humans. There's no Titans, and there's no AI. Like, it's just basic, like, Call of Duty multiplayer, I'd describe it, just exactly like that.
Okay.
Yeah, so there's a bit of everything.
So is this a game that you're excited about, Briar? Is it something?
Oh, God, I love Titanfall. I can't wait to get Titanfall 2. Yeah, I was planning. So I made a scheduling error. Well, I didn't make a scheduling error. I just made a mistake in my own head. I thought I was supposed to do a charity stream this weekend. I thought it was on Saturday. It was on Sunday. My goal was to actually stream Titanfall all day today. Like, that was the goal. Right. I was just going to wake up and start streaming Titanfall 2 all day. But I had to do that charity stream. Not that I had to do it. I wanted to do it. But so I'm really looking forward to getting into it. I might play a little bit tonight just to wet my whistle on it a little bit before I do a stream on it. But, yeah, I can't wait. Everything I've read, everything that I've heard about this game says, like, this is a way better version of Titanfall. It's got a campaign. The campaign is super fun. The multiplayer is even better than it was in Titanfall 1, which I liked the multiplayer in Titanfall 1 a lot. It feels good. It looks good. It's going to get an upgrade for the PS Pro, which is really exciting. So there's just, I mean, there's not a downside to this game that I've seen yet. I've seen people running on PC. It looks phenomenal. I've seen people running on Xbox One and PS4. It looks phenomenal. It plays really well.
Like, the frame rate's very smooth. Yeah. Yes, that's another thing.
Like, I'm just down. I am down.
I was late to the Titanfall party, but, and I know, Briar, you were a huge proponent of the game before I got it. I remember watching you doing your comparisons to the original Xbox 360, Xbox One, just all into Titanfall. Mm-hmm. When I finally got my hands on it, the thing that kind of surprised me the most was how well it controlled. And it was really the first-person shooter that I played that allowed you to run on walls and this new mobility. I'm looking forward to playing this, especially getting in early as I can.
Yeah.
Because I was really, really late to the original Titanfall party. I ended up getting my Xbox One, maybe a year after the Xbox One launched. So
it
shouldn't be too long for me. I'm thinking maybe within the next month or so, I'll go ahead and pick that up. Kate actually alerted me this morning. She said, Titanfall 2 is out, while she was playing PlayStation VR. So I'm looking at the wall. I'm looking at the TV and my pregnant wife spinning around the living room talking about Titanfall 2, and I'm thinking wife about my fault.
Yeah, it's weird. These Friday releases all of a sudden, like, it seems like every game comes out on Friday now. Like, it was Tuesday for the longest time, and now Friday's the big day.
They finally figured out payday, Brian.
You know what I think it actually is that they're not that concerned. It used to be the Tuesday release was because of shipping. Right, it's like that's when they could reliably get it to stores.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
was for Tuesdays. Now they don't really give a shit about retail, so let's get it out for the weekend when everybody has time to play. Yeah, and payday. Payday is often on Fridays. All right, Beastly. Speaking of payday, you're gonna be looking forward to your next one.
You got that right.
You're really depending on it. Yeah.
You know, we're eating ice water with ice cubes and ramen noodles tonight, but hey, we got VR.
Yeah.
So. I went on and got PlayStation VR this Wednesday, and it was on payday, believe it or not. And my wife, you know, I was at my office, and my wife was sending me pictures of her holding the box.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to damn walk out of the office and scream, I quit. I was so excited to get home.
Feeling a little sick.
Yeah. So
I think I got to take this day off all of a sudden. I'm sorry, guys. Oh,
I did that day. I left early on Wednesday because I went in early on Wednesday because I knew Wednesday I was getting it. So I got off like 2.5 hours early. So I was really excited to get home and play this thing. Took a few minutes to set it up. Finally set it up, put it on, and God, I was totally amazed. I wrote my review, my early impressions for PlayStation VR today. And to sum it up, it's really, really hard to sum it up in words exactly how immersive this experience is. If you're a PlayStation 4 owner and you have the expendable income and the extra cash and you want something different, something that's going to really put you in a game, PlayStation VR is imperative. It's something you have to try. You have to buy if you want to have the new stuff, if you want to have something that's amazing. And when I say amazing, don't take that lightly. The experiences I've had at this point are unlike any experience I've ever had in gaming. And I've been gaming, God, for 30 years. And this is truly the dream that we've had since we were young, since Briar and I were kids. The idea of actually, you know, inserting ourselves.
Too. I'm still a kid, though, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, once they invented fire, I mean, this was the next big thing for us.
Yeah. I mean,
10,000 years ago, man, the cavemen were like, oh, I can't wait for virtual reality 10,000 years from now.
Let me just say, you know, when we were young, things like Tron, that encompassed for us what VR was, or playing Punch-Out in the arcade and seeing the wireframe of Little Mac. In our mind, that's what VR was, and we had to, you know, mentally put ourselves into that frame. Now you can actually do it. I got PlayStation VR. I waited for about a day until I started buying games because I wanted to play through the demos to see what was actually available. And man, some of these experiences really, really blew my mind.
All right, before you get to the games, I want to ask you a couple of questions about the helmet, like the actual hardware. You know, it comes with like that little add-on box for your PS4, and then it's got the helmet. What did you think of the headset itself? Did you, you know, was it...
I was pleasantly surprised. It doesn't feel like, you know, an Xbox Elite controller or anything, but it does feel sturdy enough. It doesn't feel like it's going to break. You know, I have a big head, and I have brothers with heads bigger than mine. And so they all came over. It was like a train of giant heads coming through the house. And we...
Those gorilla noggins.
You got that right. And we were, you know, stretching this thing out, putting it on these big ass biscuits over the whole weekend. And it lasted, and it worked fine, and everybody had, you know, plenty of time to kind of fully articulate it and get their focus just right and get into these worlds. I was actually pretty impressed with it. I never felt like it was pressure on my face, which is what you would expect, I guess, from a VR helmet. You would think that something's kind of pushing on your face, but the way that it's made, it goes right around. And see, I have a hook in the back of my head. I was born with one. It got bigger as I got bigger. But it kind of fits perfectly on my head, and you're able to kind of pull out the visor and kind of position it just how you need it to be. Mm-hmm. It blocks out all light, and it really makes you feel like you're in these experiences. I thought the helmet was fine. The improved earbuds also helped quite a bit.
Yeah, they're not bad, right? Not bad.
Yeah, I was really shocked. Some little
I expected, you know, you mentioned pressure. I expected it to feel like wearing goggles, right? Mm-hmm. Like ski goggles or a scuba mask. But really, the pressure's kind of on your forehead.
Right here. Yeah.
Yeah, and you could really forget about it, to be honest with you. It's like it's very comfortable.
Yeah, I was really surprised. And see, when I played it months ago, I went to the GameStop and took my wife, and we sat down and enjoyed it. I didn't really get a chance, and the girl put it on my head, didn't know what the hell she was doing. She probably never saw a head like mine before, so the visuals were really, yeah, she didn't. You know, you said forehead, I got an 8-head, but it was really hard for me to fully get, you know, the focus right where I needed it to be. And so bringing it home, my big question was, is my head too much for this headset? And it wasn't. I actually figured it out. It works really, really well. You know, if you're having a hot day, you're going to have to take them off and, you know, use some wet wipes to clean the lens, because if you sweat, if it's warm, it's going to get foggy inside that thing. But
that's,
damn it.
That's true. It does. Yeah, it
I does. Know.
Yeah. My older brother, you know, he almost shit himself yesterday with the kitchen demo. And he, when he took it off, there was tears coming down his eyes and sweat and blood coming down the helmet. And I had to fuck it off because, man, he was awesome. Done.
Whoa.
My older brother, he's a big muscle-bound buffoon, but it's amazing how a VR demo can turn you into a straight-up bitch. And I saw this with my entire family. The man who taught me to be a man was screaming like
Turns
a little
Turns out he's
girl.
A little bitch, too.
You got that right. I'm sorry, man.
Family little bitches.
Yeah, I mean, this thing is incredible, guys. And for the people out there who played it, you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I uploaded a video of my son's first impression of playing The Kitchen, the Resident Evil demo, which is also the first demo I tried when I got home because I'm a big Resident Evil fan. I was totally taken aback by the depth of the what you can see. It's not like looking at a static image.
No.
You're sitting there, and like the first thing I did, there was a chair across from me, and I like repositioned my head, and I could see the area behind the chair actually changing as it would in real life. And I was like, this is unbelievable.
It
and
doesn't translate into words like what
you're
seeing.
You can't really do it.
Like you can't, I mean, it really is like being there.
Someone.
Yeah, you got to see
it. It's so incredible. And one thing I noticed is when you're watching it on the screen and you put the helmet on, what you're seeing is totally different. In the helmet, it actually looks better than what you've seen on the TV.
Yeah, it looks a lot
If you don't believe
better.
Me, try it with Resident Evil. It's totally different. The games I played blew my mind. Battlezone, Rush of Blood, Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, which is one of my favorite games. I had
What'd
to
you think?
That.
Of, okay, so you started off with Battlezone. What'd you think of Battlezone? I really enjoyed it. I only played the demo, though. I haven't bought the full game yet.
I didn't buy the game either. Battlezone is one of the best feeling games because some of these games will make you sick as shit. All right, and Brian, you were telling me that last week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Battlezone was one that I put on, and I couldn't believe it. It felt so smooth because of the way the tanks – it's a tank game where you go out into these very colorful, cel-shaded type of environments, and you're fighting these computer-controlled AI bots.
Yeah.
And it just feels really good. It controls the way that you would expect this type of game to control, but you're sitting inside this huge cockpit, and you're looking around inside. You can see what kind of ammunition you got. You can see where your feet
that
go.
That is
all this
cool,
stuff.
Man. Like that's instead of having like a HUD, like you have in like every first-person shooter, I love being able to look at like a display on my console. Like whether I'm in a driving game looking at a real speedometer or looking over at the side view mirrors or looking at the ammo counter. I love that. I love the feeling of being in the cockpit.
Let me just tell you this. I've always told you guys for years now that I'm not a fan of driving simulators.
Mm-hmm.
I'm buying Drive Club VR.
Yeah, it's pretty fun, man.
Now, that game can also get you with the motion sickness, though, if you stay in it too long.
Yeah.
And so the very first time I tried it, Nothing went wrong. I got into the car, didn't have a top, had side mirrors. I'm looking in the mirrors. I'm looking as I'm driving past buildings. I'm feeling like there's wind blowing in my face. It seems so realistic. But when you are driving it, I didn't really understand last week when you said that once you're actually playing the game, the resolution takes a major hit.
Yeah.
It does. In Drive Club, you could be like, is this Drive Club or is this something on Sega Saturn? I mean, but the fact that you're actually in there and you're experiencing it like this is really a testament to the technology.
Yeah. It's like the dream for me is being able to look around a corner and bring the car to it. Like that is, to me, that's how real driving feels. Like you don't look straight over the steering wheel when you're driving. You look at where you want to be going and you bring the car to that position.
Yeah. You know? And it felt like real driving. And my son, when he tried it, you know, he's 15, he's getting ready to start learning to drive. Yeah. He said, Dad, this must be what real driving feels like. I said, yeah, but you don't use a controller, son.
Yeah, and you're going about 100 miles an hour slower.
Yeah. It's a lot different. Yeah,
It blew my mind, the fact that they were able to do this. And the thing is, right, this is the first generation of this technology. Mm-hmm. This is the first generation of PlayStation VR. And if we look at, if history is any indication of what we're going to get by the end of this console generation or the PlayStation 4 life cycle, it's going to be dramatically different.
All right.
And so...
tell me more about the games you play, because I want to talk about the games, because now I finally got somebody to talk about these games with.
Okay.
So let's go through the games, right? We already talked about Battlezone. I love Battlezone, too. It's so smooth and fluid and fun. I'm definitely buying that game, by the way. Did you try out Eve Valkyrie?
Yeah, well, Eve Valkyrie, that was the game I tried initially in a demonstration. Mm-hmm. I tried it. I played it a couple of times here. It feels just as great as it always did. I just wish the demo was a little bit longer. Mm-hmm. I didn't buy that game. Okay. That was not a game I bought. And so I played it. It feels great. I'm wanting to play more of it.
Yeah. But the multiplayer is fun in that.
Yeah, that's the thing, right? I really want to get that. I ended up buying Batman Arkham VR.
Mm-hmm. What did you think of that?
It's awesome.
Really?
The thing I didn't know that you had to basically teleport around to do things.
Yeah.
My initial thoughts were that you could actually walk around because it's made by Rocksteady. You would think that it has some similarity to the real Batman games, but basically you go to particular crime scenes or you go to investigate detective style and there's all these things for you to interact with. And then once you do that, you use your grappling hook and grapple out of there. And basically it's a teleport.
Yeah.
It does feel pretty awesome looking in the mirror, seeing Batman.
Yeah, that does feel cool.
And standing on top of these buildings and feeling like Batman. And, you know, I was looking at Kate. She was Batman. She thought it was the best thing ever.
The Batarang feels really good in that.
Yeah.
Like throwing that feels good. But it was boring just standing. I felt like I was just standing around. It was boring.
That's really the thing. Initially, I didn't know that was the case. The whole experience of actually embodying Batman is exciting. Who hasn't wanted to be Batman? You finally got an opportunity to do it. I just wish it was implemented in a more interactive way rather than... you teleport here, you're scanning this, you're watching this shit play out, and then you got to figure out what's going on. I haven't gotten too far into the game.
Mm-hmm.
What I've seen so far, it is a nice showpiece for people who want to see new VR. I just want to see where this kind of technology goes.
Yeah.
I want to see where this technology
goes. Sorry, I was yawning when I said that.
I want to see where this technology goes in the future.
Yeah.
I also bought Until Dawn, Rush of Blood.
Yeah, what'd you think of that?
That's probably the most fun I've had so far. As far as any of the games I played, it looks beautiful. I didn't get motion sickness at all.
Mm-hmm. There were a couple of times I did get a little motion sickness, but I think it was almost intended. Like there's a couple of the, because you're on a roller coaster the whole time, and there's a couple of like woof, and it's like I felt like whoa. Yeah.
You better be good with roller coasters.
Last night, my older brother Joe came by, and that was one of the games he played, and he was just really smitten with the whole idea of the move control. My dad, 61 years old, kicking ass on Rush of Blood. He was dogging him too, and he said, "Wow, son, this is finally a game that I can play."
Mm-hmm.
So it was really awesome. But I watched my brother go down a roller coaster in Until Dawn last night, and it was the funniest thing in the world. Because he got up on his tiptoes. He's on a chair. He was on his tiptoes and leaned forward and he jumped back. And I'm sitting from the side watching him just cracking up laughing. It's really, really incredible. I streamed
that entire game, Beastly. And I actually went back and watched a couple of parts that, from what I remembered, were pretty memorable. And there's like parts where you're like, you're doing this to like avoid stuff that's coming at you.
The blades, yeah.
But also like the scares. Like there's a couple of jump scares in that. It's not a scary game, but there's a couple of jump scares where it really kind of got to me. Because like that shit is, it feels like that shit is right in your face. It's not like a movie screen, right? It's right here.
Yeah. Well, the one demo that I played that really embodied that sense of actually being there and being teleported out of reality into a different place was the kitchen.
Yeah.
The Resident Evil kitchen demo. When you actually sit in there and you're in that chair and you look down, you see your arms. You know, you're holding the controller, but your hands are tied. Yeah. And wherever you move is actually articulated in the game. And you can actually see your shoulders fully rendered in the game. And your legs are there. And mm-hmm. you're looking around. And all this stuff is happening. I'm not going to spoil for people who haven't experienced it. But I got the holy shit, and I haven't uploaded this video yet. I got scared so bad in this game that by the time I took it off, man, there was tears coming down my face. I was done.
Yeah.
And that whole sense of actually being there and feeling so helpless is, I think, going to really translate well into the final game. I don't know if they're going to do it like this, where you'd sit in a particular place.
Yeah, I don't know, because that game is like, there's another demo out there that's just, you know, a standard controller on a TV game, right? So, like, how much of this game is going to be VR and how much of it is going to be just regular, like a regular game?
I hope that a majority of it's regular game. I mean, I would prefer if you're able to walk around and enjoy it in VR. Who knows if that's what they're going to do. Mm-hmm. If they're not going to do it that way, I would prefer just to keep it kind of the traditional demo that we got rather than just sit in one spot and figure out what's going on. But one of the funniest things ever happened to me last night. My older brother, he's a year and a half older than I am. He's a muscle-bound maniac. Big muscle-bound guy. Jacked. 240 pounds. He was sitting in my living room, you know, in this chair, playing this game for the very first time. And there's a particular section in this demonstration where this creature, this woman, comes up to you and she gets ready to stab you.
Yeah.
And she stabs you in the leg. And I was watching my brother, you know, I'm recording him with my camera, and his legs started jumping like this before she stabbed him. And then when she stabbed him, he jumped back. Oh, man, it was just really, it took me by surprise just how immersive this thing can be. Mm-hmm. I played tons of demos.
Did you check out the heist, the London heist?
Yes. And then that's the game that scared my dad. My dad's another big jack guy. A London heist is where you basically are. You're being interrogated by the mob.
Yeah.
And there's this big ass jack guy who walks in there and you're tied up. And he comes in your face. He starts basically asking you where this girl is. Is it a female? Yeah. And he's really pissed off. He's got blood all over him. And basically, I watched my dad go through this. And my dad, he had his wife behind him. And you know, my dad's a manly man, you know? He watched Clint Eastwood growing up. And he's watching the screen and trying to be tough. And this guy, like, slams something down. And to see my dad jump almost out of the chair blew my mind. It was just, it's incredible how they're able to relay these feelings of truly being transformed into a completely different situation, yeah. A completely different place.
And so there's that part, though. But there's also the shooting in that game, which I think is intense and fun as hell. There's two pieces to it. There's one part where you're kind of sitting still and you're using like a desk as cover. But I think the better portion is you're in a car and you're shooting at motorcycles and SUVs on the highway.
Haven't
gotten to that yet? Oh, no. Shit, Beasley. That is fun as hell.
Once you beat the first one, that's when it goes back to the main screen and then you go to the second one.
Yeah.
But you got to keep in mind, I got a house full of people. Everybody's trying to try.
Yeah, everybody wants to play. Yeah,
so
okay.
That's what I'm going to play next. But the part that you're talking about, there has been no game ever, in my opinion, that has this level of interactivity, immersion with the shootout. Because you're behind this desk. It has a clock on it. There are guys, goons coming in from three or four different places above you, in front of you, to the right. And you can kind of hide in the cracks and crevices of the desk and shoot through these little open spaces like you can in real life. And the feeling of doing that is unlike anything we've ever experienced before. Of course, you can do it in traditional games on TV.
Yeah, and you're using the controller.
So it like, feels
You know,
real.
Like you're trying to like stick it between the desk sideways like it's a gun.
Yeah.
You know, and you're...
And it works.
Yeah, it works.
It works well.
Yeah.
It's just... I can't wait to get more and more into this. I haven't had the time with it as much as I wanted to. Mm-hmm. You know, my boys this semester are coming over only on the weekends. They stay with their mom. They come with me on the weekends. And so since they got here on Friday, they've been trying to, you know, usurp all the time with PlayStation VR. And, you know, I'm a dad, so I'm letting them play it. But it's incredible, man. It's definitely, to me, it was a very worthy investment. After buying the games I bought, which is Batman PlayStation VR Worlds, which is a great showpiece. if you buy a PlayStation VR, that's something you should definitely have to.
The VR worlds, yeah, for. Definitely.
Yeah, it has Luge, it has Ocean Descent.
Did you try that Luge?
Yeah.
Oh my god, that was vomitorium for me.
That was another game where I felt it. I felt the motion sickness where you kind of lean back and you tilt your head to go and. Mm-hmm.
If but you hit something, it like it's such a jarring motion.
Yeah, that Luge is not that great.
No.
Now, something happened to me this morning when I was playing Battlezone that never happened before. The game glitched out on me.
Mm-hmm.
I was inside the tank. I was going straight ahead because I've had so much fun with it over the weekend. And the game started skipping frames. And I immediately felt like I had to throw.
Yeah.
I took the helmet off and I swear I couldn't play anything for 30 minutes.
Yeah.
I don't know what happened.
That's what I do too. If I even start feeling it, I take it off. I don't go back to that game. Like some games, like I think they live here or where they live or something like that.
Yeah. That's horrible.
Where fuck, man. I don't even understand what they were thinking with that game, releasing it in the state it's in. It is unbelievably bad.
Well, for people who don't understand what Brad is saying, Where They Lie is another survival horror type of game set in a first-person mode. You can actually see yourself walking around, but the controls are very convoluted, and really they don't complement VR at all. Basically, wherever you're aiming the controller, as far as actually physically moving it, your flashlight goes to. You use your left analog to actually move right or left or up, forward or back, but you're aiming your controller with your flashlight, and if you decide to turn around with the right thumbstick, you don't actually turn. It skips frames, like 5 or 6 frames, and you basically teleport to the next pinpoint in that direction.
Oh, God.
So
it's really bizarre.
It's very jarring. It feels very frustrating, and it'll make you sick as hell. That's the first game that Kate played where she took the helmet off and said, nope, I'll never play this again.
Yeah, I played it for like a half hour. And, like, the setting was interesting, and, like, I wanted to know more about the world and the game.
But the way it was implemented
Man, it was like, I got sick, I had to take off the helmet, it ended my stream for me. It was like, okay, I'm done, I gotta go lay down for a bit.
Yeah, it's really bad. Yeah. Well, another game that did that to me, and it actually did to my son, too, is one that I wish that it didn't do it, was Riggs. Yeah, well, I mean, it hasn't been every experience. Like I said, I played Battlezone once, and then I played it again, and I was dizzy. Riggs, the first 3 or 4 times I played it, nothing wrong. It was totally fine. The last time I played Riggs, halfway through it, I was like, oh, my God, I can't do this. What is going on? I felt like, I don't know how to describe it, but whatever the technology is, it has to be nailed down. Of course, it's new, and I guess it all depends on the developers, because if you look at Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, they've implemented it so well, it's really hard for you to get sick. And you're moving extremely fast, maybe because it's on a track. But I don't get that sick feeling that you get when you have free roaming movement.
What I hope isn't the case with this and with all VR is that they can't get first-person movement right. Like I hope that is not the case, because I don't want every game for VR to be you sitting in a chair or you standing still.
Or right? Being Batman teleporting around.
Yeah, I don't like that.
Sounds like fun.
I want to, like, Riggs, I liked. I didn't buy it yet, but I might buy it. I really love EVE Online. Like, that thing hits me right in the nerd bone. You know, that thing is a lot of fun. But there are, like, there's a first-person shooter on that VR Worlds demo that is, I can't even play. Like, it looks cool, but it makes me sick immediately.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about. This is the one my son played where you're like an alien or something.
Yeah, it's like Scavenger or something like that.
Yeah. Scavenger. Yeah, that's the one. I didn't play it. My son played it. He took the helmet off. So, yeah, some of these games just don't translate well. There is another game on the VR demo that I played that I fell in love with. I think it's called Thumper.
Yeah, Thumper's fun.
That is really something. Thumper
looks cool. Yeah.
It's really something special.
Yeah, I bought the full version of that because that is fun. I haven't played through it a whole lot, but it's fun.
Now, I might be getting the name wrong. Thumper is the one where you're with the blocks, correct?
No, Thumper is the one where you are like a beetle.
The ladybug? Oh, yes.
You're a beetle on a track. Oh, my God. It's fun.
God, it's so good. Yeah. I played that for the first time yesterday, Briar.
Mm-hmm.
And the people around me were like, Dad, it looks boring. I was like, shut the fuck up.
Yeah, it's not. Incredible. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Gary's in the chat, too. He's making sure we mentioned Playroom VR. Did you check that out?
No, I haven't tried.
Oh, God. BC, check that out. It's just this one little level of like a 3D Mario world style game. and it is unreal, like, how good it is.
Really?
Yeah, it's just one level. It's like, imagine just, like, one little stage at it, like, and it's the first stage, so it's not even, like, a long, complicated stage. It is amazing. It's free, too. Playroom VR.
Are you talking about Mario? Are you talking about Mario, like, Mario 64 type of Mario?
Yeah, or? Like a Mario 64 style
really?
Of game. Yeah.
You're that little robot guy?
Yeah, you're like the little white robots from Playroom.
Now, this is what I'll say, right? I'm so damn happy that I bought this thing because now I don't have to worry about buying it again.
Yeah. And who's got a dog barking in the background?
I only have cats.
But I don't have a dog. Yeah.
I don't know what she's feeling.
I mean, the cat's sleeping on the bed.
Are you? I don't hear a dog. Are you sure it's not your dog's, Briar?
What the hell?
Who let the dogs out? Who?
Robbie, seriously?
Yeah. Seriously.
Briar, who let the dogs out? Because we don't have dogs. Robbie, you have a dog, don't you? You have a cat.
What?
Just a cat.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. I don't have a dog, Briar.
Briar, it's just you going crazy at CH.
What is going on here?
What? I don't hear no dog.
Look at his eyes, Robbie. Look at his
chat. Because I don't know.
Look at Briar's eyes. He's really hearing it. He's hearing
Briar's hearing something.
This is awesome.
I have no idea where that's coming from.
Maybe it's VR, Briar. I don't know.
I'm looking to see if like Discord is open and it's like somebody at Discord like with a dog barking. I have no idea what's going on here.
Oh, the only thing open here is Skype. That's it for me. Wow. Awesome.
Weird. Anyway.
But it makes me feel really good to know that the multitude of hundreds of dollars is spent because a lot of these games on PlayStation VR are pretty damn cheap. I don't know exactly the name of the game because for some reason I had it at the start of the show and then I thought Thumper at the last minute. But there's a game, I think it's only $20, where you're sitting at like this round table and this little robot flies in and starts talking to you. And basically you got to stack these blocks.
Oh, right. Yeah. I haven't played that game yet. It's like a 3D Tetris, right?
Briar, it is so amazing. It is like my addiction. I didn't even think to buy it at first because I was looking at some of the bigger titles. But it's definitely on my list. And also a game that we love here, and even my little six-year-old who had to stand on the ottoman to play, is Job Simulator. Man, insane. That's the one that my wife has been playing quite a bit. It's just crazy fun. It works really well. And it's a VR experience that you can actually walk around in a kind of an open space and do things in. It's not like you're just sitting there. You actually can turn around, take a few steps, do this, come on back, bring stuff. It's just really, really crazy. PlayStation VR is incredible. And I know it is. It's definitely a financial decision. If you're living at home with your parents, it costs more than, you know, modern systems. But if you're able to get it, I think that probably within the next year, it'll pay for itself as far as entertainment value. It's really awesome. I'm happy I got it. And until I'm able to recoup that ramen noodles chicken flavor in the Beastly.
Woo! Yeah. Hey, ramen is good. I love ramen. I'd come over.
Yeah. All right, so I think Briar's still hearing the dogs.
Yeah, what the hell is that coming from?
Hitman in the chat says it's probably VR dogs. I mean,
this is awesome because, you know, the funny thing is, right, I'm looking at Briar's face and you can tell he's really, really confused as to where the fuck
he's like freaked out by this. Yeah, you look like you just want to figure out what it is.
It's all in his eyes. He's like, what the fuck is happening? Look at him.
I have no idea where this noise is coming from, but I can hear people talking and I can hear a dog.
I heard it once too.
Chat hear it?
I don't know. I asked him. I don't think anyone...
I heard it.
I think I heard it once. Yeah, I don't know what.
I heard a dog bark. Oh, shit. Somebody's hacked into you, Briar.
I have no idea what it is. That is so weird. That is bizarre.
Wow.
I can't figure out where it's coming from.
Beastly Thoughts brought to you by Anonymous. Ruff, ruff. All right.
So, yeah, they're saying they hear it loudly.
That's it. Yeah.
The chat hears it loudly?
Yeah.
Really? People saying they can hear it. I don't hear a dog. What is going on? I think I heard it like once.
I heard a dog bark once.
All right, everybody be quiet. Everybody be quiet. That's so weird, man.
I don't hear it.
Did you hear it just now, Brian?
Is it someone's TV or something?
This is going to drive us crazy. I can't. I don't hear it.
Spoopy.
No, we're on the eve of Halloween. This might be a cause.
I think Robbie is messing with you. I'm getting that feeling too.
Oh, it's not me. We don't have a dog. Unless someone brought their dog over or something and I didn't know about it. I don't know.
All right, anyway, let me talk about what I've been playing. Obviously, Destiny. Today, we did a charity stream with the Dames of Destiny. It was pretty fun. We got the crew from the Destiny Community Podcast together and did a Wrath of the Machine raid. It was pretty funny. We got Datto in there. A lot of people will know Datto is a pretty big Destiny YouTuber. That was a lot of fun. He was very disappointed in our skills and our ability to complete the raid.
Let him down. No.
It was a lot of fun, man. It was great. I'll be hosting that stream. They're still going. So I'm going to be hosting that stream after this show. But it was a lot of fun. I've been playing a lot of Destiny, and I'm looking forward to playing a lot of Titanfall 2 because that game definitely is right up my alley.
What you squeeze in there, Briar?
An Engram? I got a bunch of these.
Briar squeezes an Engram.
Engrams from
when he has a break.
They're like little stress balls.
That's so awesome, Briar. The king of Destiny. So the
Oh, I gotta show you this. Check this out. Whoa, it's a fucking thorn!
Oh, it's a thorn!
Oh, that is amazing. Where did you get that? That's awesome.
Superman sent it to me. What the hell is that sound, man?
I don't hear it. I don't know.
I'm muting Robbie. If it goes away when I mute Robbie, then we know where it's coming from.
Somebody's eating chips or something. Or somebody's in the Skype call
that we don't know about.
Is he muted?
I don't even know how to mute him.
I'll go check real quick.
It sounds like there's somebody in the Skype call that we don't know about. But yeah, this thorn though is dope. Look at this. The barrel comes out, like, so you can reload it. It's magnetic. It goes in there magnetically and it spins in the thing. This thing is so cool. It's made by Impact Props. It's like a 3D printed item. Fucking too cool. Too cool.
Wow, man. You're the man, Briar.
So I got, you know, now I'm starting to get like this Destiny collection of shit that I'm going to have to like do something with. You know, I'm going to have to get like a display case like you got behind you.
It needs to be right behind you. Wow, that's junk. Sick.
I got all this junk now.
Well, behind me is pretty much a bunch of junk too. You know, I like junk.
Right.
I got my Lady Deadpool, she's got lots of junk in the trunk. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's the kind of stuff I like.
That's a nearly naked woman, plastic sized.
I can confirm there are no dogs in our house. And what was that about a naked woman?
All right, so we got some news. Let's hear it.
What was that?
This is a very good show. Get us started, Briar. I mean, Robbie.
What?
Get us started with some news, man. Damn it.
Sorry. Okay. Enough dog conspiracies, too. Let's move on. All right. On to the news, guys. So, first piece of news this week. Nintendo Switch will not be backwards compatible with Wii U or 3DS games. A Nintendo representative has confirmed this week.
Oh.
Come on. Like, I'm not surprised by this. Are you guys?
No. How are they going to make it DS? How is it going to be DS compatible? It doesn't have dual screens. Wii U
compatible. That makes no sense. Like, yeah.
Well, I'm thinking that they probably could make a compromise with 3DS games and give you the option of just playing with just a top screen, possibly, on some games, being that it's a cartridge-based system. But in my opinion, it's time to move on from that shit. I really don't want to play a new Nintendo console with 3DS graphics. It's so old at this point. It's so dated. You know, my cell phone is a few years old. It looks better than a 3DS on any day. I want Nintendo to step, as they used to say 20 years ago, step into the 90s. Shit. Yeah. So, I'm really that old.
Brian. I was born in the 90s. Jeez. Wow.
Yeah. So, I want to see. Briar's going to go shoot a dog.
He's going to poison it with thorn. Time. Yeah.
So, I think Nintendo's Switch should carve out its own niche. Now, if Nintendo's able to, you know, somehow create their own new PlayStation Network / Xbox Live service that allows you to pay $50 a year for a ton of backwards compatible games from the Nintendo, Super Nintendo, Nintendo 64, GameCube, and possibly Wii on that, and you pay $50 a year, and maybe you get a few hundred games. That would make the Nintendo Switch even more consumer friendly.
That is a brilliant idea.
And I'm wondering if all the people who bought the old games for like the Wii U are going to have to rebuy them again for the Switch.
The Switch.
I would hope not. That would suck.
They had to if they bought the Wii. If they bought them on the Wii on the Virtual Console, they had to rebuy them on the Wii U. It was cheaper to rebuy them, but they had to do it.
I have a feeling you're probably going to have to. Something tells me, like, this is just a whole new device. I think they're moving completely away from...
That's bullshit. You know that, right? Because it's all it's all running on an emulator.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It sucks, but I bet they're going to do it.
That's real fucked. Like, right. That's real fucked.
the person who gave me the whole idea, maybe close to a year ago, was you, Briar, of them... the possibility of Nintendo kind of adopting the same kind of services Sony and Microsoft... for a backwards compatibility catalog.
It'd be awesome.
Do you think there's a possibility they might do something like this?
I don't know, man.
They don't have a pay service.
They're not that smart. If they had a pay service, I would pay it, man. If I had access to any Nintendo game, like from Wii back, hell yeah, that'd be awesome. Even if I didn't subscribe to it 12 months a year, like even if I just said, oh, you know, I wouldn't mind playing like, you know, some Castlevania 2.
Oh, man.
Like, all right, you know, I'll subscribe this month. And while I'm there, you know, I bought the whole month. Maybe I'll play a little Mega Man 2 as well. And maybe I'll play a little Super Mario 3. I haven't played that game in forever. You know, hey, you know, Super Mario 3 was fun. I haven't played Super Mario World in a long time.
Yeah,
you know, man. Like, oh, man, that'd be so good. That'd be so good.
That would be so good.
Well, I think they'd be, I mean, especially now with the kind of the way that these premium services have litter the landscape when it comes to home consoles. I think Nintendo would be incredibly stupid not to implement something like this when they see that gamers are there. Everybody's willing to pay. Everybody's paying for this. You know, half of PlayStation 4 owners have PlayStation Plus.
So that's money on the table. Like everyone would buy this if there was a subscription service. Everyone would buy it.
This is all you need to know. Absolutely. Last year, PlayStation Network by itself made more money than Nintendo as a complete company.
Mm-hmm.
So PSN made more money than Nintendo, and we're talking about just the network service alone. So Nintendo's got to be looking at that and saying, wow, if we get outdone by a network service, we're getting screwed. Yep. We're just leaving it there. We need to implement some way to get people more value for Nintendo service. And obvious that people are willing to pay for it. I'd pay for it. If Nintendo did something like that, I'd pay $100 a year. I would. I mean, if come on, GameCube, Wii, Super Nintendo, Nintendo 64, Nintendo?
Yeah.
Game Boy? Come on, imagine that.
I'm buying this thing regardless, right? Because I'm a nerd, and Nintendo makes a new thing, I buy it. That's just how, you know, that's how it's gone since forever. And then I don't play it for 5 years until Nintendo comes out with a new thing, and I buy that for 5 years.
Same here.
But I'm really hoping that this thing is good and that Nintendo makes some smart decisions here. If they could do a pay-to-play service that has their entire back catalog on it? Oh, my God.
Yeah.
How much would you pay for that? How much would you pay for it?
I swear I'd pay $100 a year. I would. You know, I mean, wow. I would. I'd pay $50 a year right now for two games a month for PlayStation Network.
If it really was their entire back catalog, I think I would pay $100 too.
I absolutely would.
And that's got to include, though, that's got to include, like, all the services that we've been gotten used to from Xbox Live and PSN. Mm-hmm. Right, it's got to include like a couple of free games a month. It's got to include, you know, online play with real matchmaking, not this fucking crazy ass like Nintendo code bullshit. Like it's got to be a real online network. But like I'm looking at people play the new or the Skyrim Special Edition right now. I've been watching a little bit of that on Twitch, and I'm thinking to myself, do I want to buy this? Because I could buy it for my PS4. And then, you know, remote play it with the PS Vita. Or do I want to wait until the Switch comes out and play it there? You know, it'd just be so much easier to play it on the Switch. PS Vita is cool. Like, remote play is cool. But there's a lot of lag associated with it. And it can be kind of frustrating. And that combat system is a little janky anyway. So, like, adding like, you know, a half a second of input lag to it could be a real nightmare. I don't know, man. Like, I'm really thinking about it.
Well, for me, the there's a lot more draw and a lot more attention for me on the what the Switch is going to be when it comes to these cartridges. You know, there's rumors, of course, there's been a lot of rumors about this thing, and a majority of them have turned out to be true, that these things are 60 gigabyte cartridges. With new technology, up-to-date technology, what can be done with a 60 gigabyte cartridge? It's probably going to be just as good as what we see on Blu-ray with half the load time. You know, I want to see just how far they can push the graphics processor of this thing. And, you know, it, basically, if we saw in the, if we saw Skyrim, or basically the way that the games look on the Switch in that trailer, which, of course, was pre-rendered, if they even come close to that, this thing is going to be incredible, in my opinion.
Yeah. You know, and Nintendo's games, a lot of people are upset that this thing isn't going to be as powerful as a PS4. But Nintendo's games don't require a lot of power.
Nope, you know, they don't.
What they focus on is like the beauty of the game. It'd be nice if it had the power of a PS4 Pro or an Xbox Scorpio so that it could get third-party games.
Probably not,
I don't think that's going to happen. I think third-party isn't going to happen on this thing, just like it hasn't happened for years on Nintendo consoles. But when it comes to you know, stuff that is single-player, stuff like Mario, stuff like Zelda, like, it's just so fucking compelling being able to, like, you know, get a little sick of sitting on this couch. I'm just going to pick this thing up, go lie in bed for a little bit. You know, it's a nice day out. I'll play out on the deck for a little while, you know?
Awesome. Yeah, man. That's...
Or, you know, I got a long wait at the DMV. You know, I'll play a little Zelda while I'm there. You know, like, that is super compelling in a way that the Vita never has really worked out for me. It's like, I'd love to be able to, you know, I'd love to play a little Destiny from bed. But it just doesn't work. It just doesn't work. But this would work, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I love the idea. I hope it works. I hope they do some kind of subscription service for their back catalog, too, because it's the fucking holy grail of back catalogs. You know?
And another thing to think about, though, Briar, is like when you said that this thing won't be able to compete with PlayStation and Xbox when it comes to graphics, Nintendo, the way that they produce their games has always been very, very pristine. One of the best-looking games of this generation was Mario Kart on the Wii U. I mean, when you look at that game, it looks as good as PlayStation 4 and Xbox One games, and it doesn't even come close to the same power. Nintendo, the way that their production values and quality that goes into their games is really second to none. So I'm excited to see what they do as far as their first parties as well. Now, you did mention Skyrim. Our next little bit of news. Bethesda has announced this week that the company will no longer send out early review copies of its games to any media outlets prior to 24 hours of the release date. Dun, dun, dun.
So I think this is a big deal because I don't know about you guys, but reviews, impressions, all that stuff nowadays is a very important part of me, my decision to purchase games, right? Like, I want to know, is this game good? How is it functioning? Sorry, funkin'. I'm having trouble.
You say
functioning on day one.
Did he just say
and
fucking?
Reviews are a big part of
he
that.
Said fucking. I don't know what's going
did.
On.
No, I think he just said fucking.
I did not.
On air, live.
Canada.
Let me finish. Yeah, so anyways, but I think you guys would agree, though, right? Like, reviews, impressions, all that stuff is very important to me because this console generation, there's been something about it where there's just not as much trust between consumers and publishers based on early releases of games. We want to see how are they functioning on day one, what is the multiplayer like and all that. And I think reviews have been an important part of that, and not having these early review copies is taking a whole stab at that.
Robbie, I would agree with you in most situations, right? But in this situation, I don't know if I can. Because when you look at the pedigree of Bethesda games, for the most part, they're pretty stand-up games. They're usually made very well. They get pretty high reviews. Now, if Hello Games if Hello Games made the same announcement, that would be a horrible, horrible announcement. Because when you look at No Man's Sky, they're like, hey, look, we're not going to release any early preview copies until 24 hours before the game is released. Nobody would buy the game. Everybody would automatically say, well, I know this game is going to fucking suck.
Yo, Beasley, Fallout 4. Yeah. Bethesda made Fallout 4. You're telling me you don't want to see a review of that game before you buy it?
I didn't have to, though. You know, I love Fallout 3. You didn't have to.
We all bought
the game.
Yeah.
Maybe, right? But then again, it's still subjective, Briar. Even though I didn't play all the way through Fallout 4 because there was myriad other games that were pulling my attention away, it still embodied the same things that I loved about Fallout 3. Maybe to a fault. Maybe it was too similar to... Maybe it was too similar to Fallout 3, but it still embodied everything about Fallout 3 that I love, and it did add some things. So I don't think it was a terrible game, and it was definitely...
It wasn't a terrible game.
It was definitely worth $60. It wasn't like we got sold short. Just with the degree of content alone, it was worth $60. And for people who love Fallout 3, those are the people who were excited about Fallout 4, and they got more of Fallout 3 and a better graphical design with more to do. So... I guess it's all subjective. Some people think Fallout 4 was game of the year. So
I love Fallout 4. I'm going to admit
perfect,
that.
Perfect example.
I really liked it.
I'm not casting any stones. All I'm saying is that a lot of people would have benefited from reading a review before they bought Fallout 4. And I include myself among that group.
I agree with you.
I don't even know if a review could have stopped me from buying that.
Same here.
Honestly, because I was so hyped for it.
But
here's the problem is that, yeah, sure, Bethesda's got a great record, and they release great games until they don't.
Mm-hmm.
What happens when they release a game that would have gotten 30% across the board, but nobody reviewed it before it came out? What happens, you know, how does this story play out then?
Right? They go dark like Hello Games.
Bethesda right now is looking at this dynamic right here. We could give this game to... IGN and to Jim Sterling and to Boogie29888 and have them review the game a week before it comes out. Have the release or have the reviews come a day before the game releases, right? So everybody knows exactly what the Metacritic is going to be on our game before it comes out. Or we could keep pumping out hype all the way until this game comes out and the reviewers get their copy just the same time as everybody else does. And then it's too late. You know, we've sold 90% of the copies we're going to sell of this game.
Like, yeah.
Why? How does it benefit me as a game developer to have these reviews when everybody is already hyped about my game?
Yeah.
And well, I can build hype easy by just putting out videos. I can hire YouTubers to talk about how good my game is. I can hire Twitch streamers to talk about how good my game is and to build hype for me. Why would I want to send early copies to a person who could possibly say my game is shit and keep people from buying it? There's no reason.
And now that you explained it that way, I gotta do a 180 and agree with you there. I think that what they probably should have done, instead of saying that we're not going to send any more review copies until 24 hours before the game releases, they should have just said from here on out, our embargoes will be up until 24 hours. Of the game release, which will still
they don't want that though. A review hitting.
They don't want
before people
review.
Are in the store buying the game or on. You know, they pre-ordered the game. The game is on their hard drive. They've gone to GameStop. They've picked it up. They want that game sold before those reviews hit. Before that Metacritic. Before Jim Sterling makes a video about how awful the microtransactions are in this game.
Mm-hmm.
They want that game sold.
Yeah, well, the lack of transparency will ultimately hurt them in the end, and that's just the guy's honest truth.
Or will this be the future? I don't know. Why, you know, like, what benefit does a game company get out of a review by Jim Sterling or IGN or GameSpot or Giant Bomb? What benefit are they providing?
Yeah, because they have enough influence from the YouTubers and the Twitch streamers who are going to promote the game.
That was the benefit. Yeah. You know, in years past,
in the beginning,
getting your game onto a magazine cover like EGM or, you know, Game Informer, getting your game on the cover and then getting previews, you know, these 10-page spreads with the preview. And then, you know, along with that, the review, like hopefully our game reviews is a 9 or a 10 so that a lot of people buy it. But those days are over. I mean, magazines are out of business except for Game Informer.
Mm-hmm.
The websites, you know, like they don't have the same power and influence they do because now if you're a video game fan,
you go to YouTube.
You go to YouTube. You go to Twitch and you watch people play the games.
Mm-hmm.
And they can pay Twitch streamers and YouTubers to say exactly what the fuck they want about that game.
Yeah. That's the truth. Definitely.
Wow.
And I think in the past too, I think reviews had a lot different impression of games than they do now.
Robbie,
like, yeah,
Robbie,
the thing has just changed.
Are you doing this every time you make a point?
I'm sorry, it's a habit. I gotta stop. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe we gotta handcuff his hands behind his.
He keeps chair. Hitting the keyboard.
That's not the solution. No, it's
that is the solution. I'm calling your mother. I'm gonna have her tie you up. We could call it right now.
On a side note, Robbie, I do appreciate your attempt to fit in with the Beastly Thoughts crew. I see your beard growing just a little bit longer and you'll be just like Brian. I see it, man. At first I thought you like cut the hair from under your arms and super glued it there, but I see what you're doing.
Real beard hair.
Good stuff. All right, so moving on, continuing on with our Beastly Thoughts news, the long-in-development Uncharted movie has a new developer once again, as Sean Levy is now set to direct the upcoming film based on the video game series.
IMDb Sean Levy.
Let's see what we got here.
All right, so previous projects have been Real Steel, which I've heard is actually a pretty good movie. I've never seen it.
It was a good movie.
I've Night of the Museum, trash. Night of the Museum 2, trash.
They're kind of stupid. Yeah.
Last Man Standing, the TV series, Arrival. That's coming out later this year. Alexander the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad, Gay. Great book. I'm not seeing anything here like that. Pink Panther 2, The Rocker.
Oh, I love Pink Panther, though. That movie is so funny.
Cheaper by the Dozen 2.
Oh,
man.
Never mind.
Yeah,
I mean, that doesn't change the fact. Like, have you guys ever been excited about this movie? Because I'm not. Oh. And I love Uncharted. I never have cared about this movie.
This is ultimately what's going to happen when they create these films that put a human face with a character that's not real. Angelina Jolie, Tomb Raider. If something goes wrong in this film, it's going to tarnish what that game has been because it's part of the canon. I mean, Naughty Dog has made these games. They've been amazing games. They told incredible stories. They've got amazing set pieces. If a movie comes out that tries to embody this whole series or part of the series, it's going to really fuck up the lineage of the game. And
I like where your head's at, man. If you got another story to tell, make another fucking game.
Yeah. I mean, that's what they're doing. They do that right. Look at the history of video game movies translated to film. It's been horrible. It's been really, really bad. I do think Assassin's Creed looks like it has potential.
It could be good. I'm going to go see like it with my friend. Hopefully,
I really like the actor they have as the main guy.
Fassbender? Yeah.
Yeah, he's really good, but that movie's going to suck. Let's be honest.
Breyer.
Come on. It's a video game movie.
It's the first good one.
We already know it's going to suck.
Might be the good one.
Well, it'll be the only good one because, it'll be the second good one because the only other video game movie that I actually liked in my entire life, and it's probably because I was a huge fan of the series, was the original Mortal Kombat film in 1995.
You can to be me, forgiven. You can be forgiven for thinking that. I also enjoyed it. And I can still enjoy it. It's campy, but I enjoy it. I actually liked the first Tomb Raider movie.
I thought that was pretty good. Yeah.
I don't need a piece of cinematic art to sit there and enjoy a movie. I just watched, the new X-Men movie. That movie is garbage. But I sat there and I watched it and I enjoyed it.
I love you, bro.
Independence Day, same thing. Yeah. This movie is dumb. It's stupid. Shit blows up. I'm having a good time watching it. I don't need a perfect piece of cinematic art. I liked the first Resident Evil movie. I thought it was all right.
I did too, and I ended up hating everyone after that.
Yeah, pretty much.
Once they decided to change every aspect of the game, if a game is successful and you want to turn it into a film, why would you change every fucking thing?
Yeah, I don't get that either. Yeah. Yeah, some of them are just terrible, though. Like, Street Fighter was awful.
Oh, God.
Mario Brothers was, like, unbelievably unwatchable.
I've heard that was terrible. I've never seen it.
Robbie, you should watch it just to see how bad it is.
I do. I will watch it. Yeah, absolutely.
As a gaming pundit and co-host of the Beastly Thoughts show, you owe it to yourself and the viewers to watch that film so you can be more informed on video game history.
Just so every once in a while when it comes up, you can hate on it with us.
Yes.
I've heard it's bad.
Wait till you see what the Goombas look like. Wait till you see what the princess, who princess is. Wait till you see how Mario and Luigi jump. John Leguizamo is Luigi. Oh my God.
Is it full of cringe? I bet
it is. Wait till you see who Koopa is. Okay? King Koopa. All right, it'll blow your mind.
So weird. Some people get enjoyment out of the Super Street Fighter movie or the Street Fighter movie in the same way.
Yes.
You know, believe it's like it's not, so bad that it's like kind of flipped over to being good because it's so bad.
It's a cult thing. When I was young, we watched Street Fighter with Van Damme and Raul Julia numerous times, over and over and over again. We played the arcade game, even though it was shit. In our young minds, we somehow flipped it into being some type of magical, amazing moment, and it was fucking horrendous. And I hate it now. It's that bad.
Gary's got it right in chat. Kylie fucking Minogue.
Kylie Minogue. Unbelievable. All right. So earlier this week, 2K and Turtle Rock Studios announced the final day of support for its online multiplayer shooter, Evolve. Rest in peace, Evolve.
Yep, that game is done.
I bought you on release. And
yeah, right?
Totally regret it.
It's the last time I played you. I thought it was going to be so big, man. It's sad to see something like that happen. But you know what, Turtle Rock? You need to go ahead and make Left 4 Dead and redeem yourself. Right? When you do something,
where the hell is you do Left something 4 Dead 3?
Right. They did that so well. They took the whole zombie genre, created something new and terrifying, added a four-player multiplayer experience, and then abandoned it to make Evolve. Get the fuck out of here. Left 4 Dead 3 is going to be amazing. Get on that. Redeem yourself. Bring the prestige back to the name Turtle Rock Studios. Yeah. That's what you need to do. That's what Beastly Thoughts and Beastly Thoughts watchers want you to do.
At least they're moving on now. And yeah, hopefully to God they do like Left 4 Dead 3 or something, because that'll definitely redeem them.
I remember the first time I played that with you guys.
Yeah, I remember and- too.
Like you go into the loading screen. You're talking, you know, you're talking about you're trash talking basically. You're talking to your friends because you're about to jump into, and then you go into the loading screen.
No more.
Where did everybody go? Did everybody leave the party? What happened? You can't talk while you're in the loading screen, and the loading screen is like, what the fuck?
Yeah, it was weird. Yeah,
it was a really bad experience, and I started to see how bad it was once everybody around me started to tell me. You know, usually my wife is with me to the bitter end.
Yeah.
It's okay. It's an okay game. But when she was like, Beastly, she doesn't call me that, by the way, unless we're alone in bed.
Just call you Beast? Uh-huh.
That's right.
You mean fucking?
You had to say it bluntly. Unless they're fucking. Yeah.
So you got that right, bro. She started telling me. She was like, this game is fucking shit. I don't want to play this anymore. I was like,
that's terrible.
But give it a chance, babe. She looked at me and was like, no. I was like, all right. I think it's over.
Sometimes the idea is good, right?
It is.
Like, you want it to be good.
And then,
there was just so many like weird things about that game that just didn't make any sense. That just drained the fun right out of it.
It was.
So does this mean that we can't play it anymore? Or what does it mean?
I believe it's still online. I just think they're not.
No more patches. No more updates. It's just no more until they decide. Wow. Okay.
God, I remember years ago. And we're on the downslope.
I mean, do you guys remember before Evolve came out, though? Like, I remember being very excited for it.
It was such a cool idea. I mean, like, it was a great idea having a cooperative game. Where you and your teammates were going after one player, and it was going to be fun as the team or as the single man controlling the monster. It seemed like it was going to be so fun. I was really hyped for it, and then it got delayed, and it was like, okay, that's fine. Delay it, add more monsters, add more levels, fine. You know, obviously you got such a good idea here that you just want to add more and make it better. And then we got it, and it was a fucking piece of shit.
I mean, I don't even think it was that fun, and it was kind of lacking content too. Like, it was kind of boring and there was nothing to do.
So and then the new content cost an arm and a leg.
Yeah, they should have had a single player campaign in there too, because
that's what that needed.
Like Titanfall, it was a cool world that needed one.
Was actually fun. That had awesome multiplayer. Evolve, not very fun. That's the difference.
All right, so we got two little short pieces of news. I want to get them out of the way. Okay, PSN has once again experienced an outage this week on PS4, of course, during scheduled maintenance for the server. This actually hit me, pissed me off. I was going to make a video about it.
This is different than last week when they got DDoS, that big DDoS?
Yeah, this is different.
Oh, no
this
shit.
Is, I didn't even hear this. This is the day I came home and I was getting ready to play PS4, but I was like, no, I'm just going to go lay in bed and watch YouTube. I came back here, turned on my PS3, couldn't sign in to watch YouTube, and I was fucking pissed. I just turned on my iPad and went to sleep. Fucking PlayStation. But yeah, that's pretty much the norm now. And the last little bit of news, Nintendo was...
One little tidbit. You turned on your iPad and then went to sleep.
What?
Yeah, that
doesn't... There's only so much YouTube I can watch before I pass out.
Wait. I'm sorry.
I watched Dr. Listen,
the sequence of events here have me confused.
Me too.
You turned on your iPod. On. And then you went to sleep.
Immediately. I turned it on and I started watching YouTube. I was watching Dr. Sandra Lee.
Like, fuck this. I'm going to bed. I'm going to turn on the TV and the lights and the fucking...
everything on. When I go to bed.
You guys remember that fucking clap one commercial with the old lady clap? Let's went to sleep real quick.
Overnight. Let's leave the microwave so on.
Fast. Right?
Yeah.
I got it. I'm thinking about going to bed. Let me turn on the microwave.
Don't forget the coffee grinder, too. Makes a lot of noise. Sleep that on overnight.
All right. So this is so stupid. The last little bit of information we got for this week's Beastly Thought Show. Nintendo has announced the next reveal for Nintendo Switch to take place on January 12, 2017 via a video presentation, of course. So we got to wait till January 12th to get any information a la price, specs on the Nintendo Switch 2 months before the actual launch of this.
Did they specify what kind of information it was going to be? For some reason, I had it. They were going to show off some games.
They're going to show up the games that are in development. They're going to reveal the price of it, and they're going to talk specs.
They said that? They said those three things?
They said price for sure and games in development.
Okay.
But I'm speculating that they have to let us know what the hell this thing has within a two-month time frame.
They could pull a Apple here and just not talk about Beyonce. Specs.
They could just do a Beyonce. And say, you'll find out when you get the box.
Right? I mean, really, what does it matter what's in that thing? Here's what it can do. You can see it in the games.
That is a good way of looking at it, yeah.
I mean, it's not going to compare favorably to 6,000 teraflops or 6 teraflops, whatever the fuck, you know, like whatever the fuck they're talking about with a Scorpio, and it's not going to compare.
Teraflops,
it's not going to do HDR 4K, you know, and it's, you know, so why even bother talking about specs?
Mm-hmm.
You know, just like here's the games. We got Mario, we got Pokemon, we got Skyrim, we got Zelda. You know, you're fucking buying it. Just line up. Shit. It's going to be $300. Pre-orders are available now.
If they come out and just show
the middle finger, I don't think they'll do that.
Yeah, probably not. Reggie seems nicer than that.
That's probably not their marketing campaign. So.
If you guys had to pick one Nintendo franchise that you wanted to see during this reveal on January 12th, which is my little brother's birthday, who got the shit scared out of him yesterday. Hi, Calvin. If you could see one game during this reveal that maybe you haven't seen in a long time, a franchise you want to be brought back, what franchise would it be?
Metroid, man.
Metroid, same here. Robbie?
Same, yeah.
Metroid, they need to revitalize that franchise. It has such a...
Yeah.
Colin Moriarty says that the fan base is not big enough and they don't buy Metroid games, but I'd be super excited to see a modern Metroid game on new hardware and see where Samus Aran is going next.
Mm-hmm. And to add to that, Retro Studios, who makes Metroid, has not released a game in 2.5 years since Donkey Kong Tropical Freeze, that's the name of it.
They have something. Let us know in the comments, guys, what Nintendo Switch game would you like to see, a first-party game, during this reveal on January 12th? What game from Nintendo would have you excited? It could be any old Nintendo franchise, maybe one you haven't seen in a long time.
I'm changing my answer. JB Mega said Earthbound in chat, and I'm changing my answer.
Oh, wow. To Earthbound. Wow. Yeah. Whoa, shit.
He's right. He's correct.
You're right. Wow. I didn't even think about that. Oh. Yeah, that
Kid Icarus? Would be really, really
awesome. Possibly, as long as it doesn't get trolled like the one on 3DS.
Oh, man, that was a mess. That was a nightmare.
Yeah. It made you remember.
Nightmare Hell Raid.
It trolled like Nutsack.
Yeah.
What the? Robbie, with the language? God.
But I've never tried to control.
I'm calling your mother, Robbie.
Yeah, you know,
I'm sure you have her number.
We both do. Okay? We love your mom. She's the sweetest. She's the reason I want to move to Canada.
Oh, you guys should, you know, because the...
And speaking of moving to Canada, I voted yesterday, guys. I stood in line for 2 hours and cast my vote.
Good. I think that's important to vote, though. That's good. Everyone should I know a lot of people don't want to, and they're not sure who to vote for. It's important you vote, though. Get out there and do it.
How does that work, Beasley? You got, like, early, like, the polls are open already for you?
Yeah.
Like, you can go to a polling station and vote?
It was a fucking huge line. I didn't put it on Twitter, the picture of the line I was in.
You'd think if you go early like that, it'd be no line.
Yeah, well, it was a fucking animal house.
I had to do a ballot, like not an online, but a mail-in ballot this year because I forgot to, when I moved to the town I live in, I forgot to register in this town. So I'm still registered in the old town.
So you had to mail it there? You're the man, Briar.
But you know what sucks is I don't get my little sticker. I'm so happy with my little sticker.
I got home and I took it off and gave it to Nova. It was awesome. You guys get out there and vote. Cast your vote. And do what you need to do. This is America. And if it doesn't go right, Robbie's got an extra room for all of us.
Right. I've seen pictures of his house. It's huge. We definitely have extra
rooms. I would live in his backyard. There's a fucking mountain in his backyard.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, have you ever seen those small homes? You know, like the people build homes on trailers?
The tiny homes, yeah.
I think I could do it. You know, all I really need is a TV and enough room for a PlayStation, right? And I'm good.
I don't think your wife and kids would be too happy. I could just see you, your wife, and the kids trying to...
In the oncoming apocalypse, it's every motherfucker for themselves.
I remember that, Briar.
That's awesome.
BC Thoughts, making better men day by day. Thank you.
I mean, as far as I'm concerned, either way this thing turns out, we're fucked.
We're fucked, yeah.
The apocalypse is coming soon.
Catch me in the woods with a slingshot hunting rabbits in a couple of months, guys.
Come to Canada. Things are good here.
I've played The Last of Us before. I can do that shit.
Right? Don't give him a bow and arrow. That shit's OP.
Mm-hmm. It's
the rabbit? Yes.
dropping bitch bombs in the middle of the woods. Yeah.
Right? Oh shit. All right. I think that's gonna do it. What do you think? It was a good show. Great. I gotta say, it was a good show, guys. I would say it's in the top 130, easy.
Yeah, really, I would have said at least top 125. But I'll go at 130 for sure.
Top 130.
We had fucking phantom dogs this episode. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, very seldom do we have a pregnant pause that lasts for 15 seconds.
Jokes in the first today, 5 minutes or so.
Listening to phantom dogs bark in Briar's ear.
I don't even know what the hell was going on with that.
Robbie gets up to check. Weird. Robbie gets up to go check and see if his mom adopted a dog in the middle of the show. This has been a very entertaining episode.
If his house is anything like my house, there could be a new fucking animal any minute. like fucking kittens flying around, dogs flying around. Who knows? It'd be a fucking goat in the living room right now. I'd have no idea. Like, oh, this is our new goat. Okay.
Hey, look, you know you're married because that's the right answer too, Brian. I like that.
All right.
It's all maybe she'll adopt a bat too. Who knows?
Maybe. Oh shit, The Walking Dead is tonight. Did you guys watch the first episode of Walking Dead?
Oh yes.
Holy shit. Those bastards.
You know what, man? He's got some shit coming his way. I can't wait till Rick gets his revenge.
Oh yeah, you know that's happening.
What did he say to him? He said, somehow it might not be today or tomorrow, but I'm gonna fuck your shit up, bitch.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Ooh. Little Carl almost got fucked up. Thank God he didn't, but some fans. You mean, it's coral, right? Like coral reef? Coral,
no,
coral,
it's coral. It's just they're all Southerners, so they say coral. They say it wrong.
Well, he's not a real, he's from Europe, so.
Yeah, but he's pretending he's to be a Britain, Southerner.
And so he's doing it wrong, because it's not coral. He's saying like coral reef.
Carl.
It's Carl.
Carl.
Get your ass in here and sit down in this chair. That's how he's supposed to say. That's real Southern.
All right, now that we've pissed off the bottom half of this continent.
Now it's an even better time to move here. Right. You guys better get your ass up.
Yeah.
You pissed off half the country. Like, book it up here quick.
Boom! Come on, done. Half the country hates us. Bang! <Yeah. laughs> It's that easy.
We're gonna get first, guys. I live in Georgia. I'm fucked.
All right. At least I got a buffer. If I stop hearing from you, I know to start running. Shit, we gotta go. Beast, I haven't heard from Beastly in like 2 hours. We're out. All right, guys, let's do this. Thank you very much for watching. We'll see you next week. This is a good show. This is a lot of fun. Thank you so much.
Bye, guys.
Thank you, Beastly. Thank you, Robbie.
Thank you, Briar. And thanks, everybody, for checking out the show. See you next week.
We love you.